Chapter 3, Jesus, 2 Br 3:1. Jesus was the son of Miriam called Mary, by Joseph. His brothers were Jacob, Joseph, Simon, and James. He was born at Bethlehem. In the days of his youth, the land rang with the exploits of Judas the Galilean, who preached that there was no ruler but God. He was called the teacher of righteousness in his day. Br 3:2. Joseph, Jesus' father, died when Jesus was 16. Righteousness in his day. Br 3:2. Joseph, Jesus' father, died when Jesus was 16. Mary, his mother, did not like his inwardness, his long silences and his solitary habits. She rebuked him for being a tardy breadwinner, but this was unjust, for he excelled in his craft. She could not understand her strange son who was unlike the others, and she wanted a practical man, not a dreamer and preacher. Br 3:3. Jesus had spells of rapture, and his male kinsfolk declared he was out of his mind, so they sought to have him put under restraint. But the womenfolk said he was harmless, and in cases such as this, their words colored the law of the land. Jesus loved his father, who had taught him his trade. He consoled himself with the scriptures which said, I will become his father and he shall be my son. Br 3:4. Jesus early became a wandering carpenter and then joined the Nazarenes. There was excitement in the land because it was said that the prophecy of Daniel was to be fulfilled in these times. The conditions of the times fulfilled the predictions. Br 3:5. Then, Jesus went into the wilderness beside the Jordan. He joined the Society of Saints, which was beside the Sea of Heavy Salt. When he came back to the Jordan, he no longer retired within himself, but was a man of direct and forceful speech. He was decisive and commanding. Br 3:6. The people called him the Galilean because he was raised in Galilee, and they sought to name him the man of messianic hope and the suffering just one, when Judas the Galilean was dead. Some thought he was the warrior Messiah, but he rebuked them, saying, I am he of whom it is written he shall judge the poor rightly and reprove those who oppress them. He shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth and slay the wicked with the words that issue from his mouth. Br 3:7. He wrought cures, as did many others in those times. The Levites put out that he did not as they, but by the power of the prince of darkness. But Jesus said that such was blasphemy, as the healing spirit of God was strong within him. Therefore, such an accusation was a sin, but they mocked him. Br 3:8. He was a true man, a good organizer, strong, alert and resourceful. He had determination and courage, though withal, he could be gentle and compassionate. He was inflexible in purpose, yet, he could bend before the storm and survive where the stubborn man would go down. Br 3:9. He stood firmly against the holy men of the Jews, whose seeming holiness was but a cloak, for it was something that flourished only in the public eye. It was woven with self-righteousness, lined with intolerance and sewn with threads of sadness. Good men do good deeds out of the sight of others and gain merit from their selfishness and sacrifices. Br 3:10. One came to Jesus. Br 3:10. One came to Jesus, saying, Lord, I give many gifts and alms to the poor. I am ever giving to the needy. I am a rich man, but my riches have come by lawful means. I have traded with ships and encountered dangers to accumulate them. Having gained wealth, I live in moderation, supplying only my moderate needs. I give the rest to the needy poor, and I am ever ready to serve the deserving. Am I then a sinner? Br 3:11. Jesus said, No, by giving with discretion and making such sacrifices, you gain merit, and there is no harm in seeking riches for worthy ends. It is the love of money for its own sake that is productive of evil. The Evils of riches arise from their misuse. If a man gains wealth in a lawful way and does not live in luxury, supplying no more than his moderate needs, serving the poor and deserving with his surplus, then he does no wrong. BRT 3:12. A teacher of the Jewish way said to Jesus, "If God is so great and all-knowing, why does he not strike down the wrongdoer? Why does he withhold his justifiable wrath when the wicked man swallows up the man who follows the path of goodness? Is he not the God of justice?" Jesus replied, "Justice is not a thing of the time. Though the mills of God grind slowly, they grind to perfection. Life itself metes out justice. The justice of God adjusts the injustice of men. Were this not so, I would not have come." BRT 3:13. Jesus was then asked if he was one with God, and he answered, "It is not in me to state that, which I know to be untrue, and truly. There can be but one God alone. Because I have been granted visions and insight into things unseen and unknown to other men, what manner of man would I be did I claim equality with God? I have spoken only that which I am bidden. I have said, 'Worship God who is my Father and your Father.' Does this then raise me above other men? I have proclaimed all men my brothers, and if I have said I am even as God, then truly I have raised them up also. Yet, this they cannot see, or is it that they fear the burden of their own godhood?" BRT 3:14. Jesus came and was like the slasher, which clears away the useless undergrowth in the forest of life. He uprooted and burned that which was unproductive. He planted good trees, but the undergrowth returns. It is a time for the activities of good men. Jesus found pearls by the seashore. He sowed the good seed in the hearts of those who followed him closely. For his sake, many of the rich became poor. BRT 3:15. He came and separated men out from the errors of the world. He brought men a mirror, into which they could look and see their own divinity. He opened a door now open to all, and those who choose to pass through stand on the road to the eternal. He raised up the fallen and healed the afflicted. He woke those who slept and reminded those who had forgotten. He enlightened the righteous and gathered in those who were lost. BRT 3:16. To what can he be compared? To the great sun that shines down, giving joy and life to all living things. To a great river giving gladness to men and the waters of life to beasts. To the good husbandman who cherishes his fields and tends his flocks. To the men of the forests who care for their trees and thankfully gather the fruits thereof. BRT 3:17. The sun shines today, and the air gleams with light. The earth puts forth blossoms, and the seas are calm. The waters flow clearly, the birds sing, and the gloomy winter has gone. Hope dawns, and so it is with the Son of Man. BRT 3:18. The tree of glory has been planted and will survive, for it is well serviced. Its servants are dutiful. So let it be like the holly, whose leaves are not shed in summer or winter, which stands with weapons ever ready in persecution or freedom, in good days and bad. BRT 3:19. He who neglects these scriptures is like the branch of a fruitless tree, his life is fruitless. Blessed are those who seek fruit that grows out of our good deeds. He who copies a book is like a maimed man who gives his weapons to a whole and healthy man. The lettered man resembles this good land, which takes the seed and nourishes it. The rains fall plentifully and the crop is good. BRT 3:20. The life men live is like an inn where they dwell shortly, or like a house rented for a limited time. Vessels of metal and earthenware are to them like borrowed utensils. Their riches are held in trust. The wise man uses them and they serve him, but he does not set his heart on these or hug them to his bosom. BRT 3:21. Who is most praiseworthy for his goodness, the son of a rich man or the son of a poor man? The rich son gives only what he himself has been given, so surely it is the son of the poor man, for he has overcome the temptations of poverty and satisfied the cry of hungry mouths with the earnings of his own labor. It is the poor who help the poor, for the rich help themselves. Brt 3:22. There are those who fast for the sake of heaven, but Jesus said, it were better did they devote themselves to learning the scriptures and to good works for the sake of heaven. Yet, it is useless to merely read the scriptures, for unless they be taken into the heart and lived by, then they are things of little value and use. The value of all sacred writings lies in what people do with them. More important still is what the scriptures do to the people. Brt 3:23. A man asked Jesus, Lord, what does it mean when it is written that the iniquities of the fathers shall be visited upon the children? Jesus said, when a man commits a sin, for which he does not make full recompense in his lifetime, then the same temptation is placed in the way of the son, for there is a bond of family blood between them. Is it not manifest also that the wrongs a man does within his own household become the sins of the sons within their households? Wrongful living is the heritage of generations. Brt 3:24. A man asked, where is God? Jesus took a piece of bread and gave it to the man, saying, take this and hold it. Then he said, put out the other hand. He poured a little water on the upturned palm and said, now you have felt the power of God, for without his spirit in the bread and in the water, these would not exist for you. Split a billet of wood, and God will be there. Lift up a stone, and you will find him. Brt 3:25. Another said, tell us how we may best serve God. Jesus replied, talk not of serving God as you would serve a king. In serving God, man serves himself. You ask in your heart, shall you be this or that or a priest? Let your own heart point the best way, and having chosen it, follow it with devotion and fortitude. Brt 3:26. At a wedding feast, Jesus was asked, Master, why do you come to this place when it is a gathering place of those who seek only their own pleasure and will drink to excess if it is provided? Jesus said, our purpose here is to make glad the hearts of the hosts and to share in their enjoyment, blending their pleasure with ours. There will always be those who are neglectful of their obligations and who concern themselves only with their own well-being. Yet, is this reason enough not to bring happiness to those who have invited us? Brt 3:27. One day, Jesus and those with him came upon an old man playing with childish things. A bow and arrow-bearing huntsman passing by mocked him, saying, behold the old man playing as a child. Jesus called him over and said, do you always keep your bow bent, the string under stress? Of course not, replied the huntsman. To do so would be foolish, for the bow would become useless were it not unbent from time to time. Jesus said, just so is it with the old man, and you should know better. Brt 3:28. The bowman strings his bow before he shoots and, when the shooting is over, he unstrings it. A bow kept always strung will break and be useless when needed. So it is with a man who never relaxes. He is ever taut within, and when the testing time comes, his stomach turns to water. Brt 3:29. Jesus taught that there are things which should be approached with humility of spirit. They are holiness, wisdom, and nobility. Humility bestows upon the soul the benefit of harmony and attunement. A man once said to Jesus, but who can define these things? That which is holy to one man can be unholy to another. The thing which one man holds sacred, another holds to be an abomination. That which one will bless, another will curse. Jesus said, the many nations and men, because of the diversity of their natures, hallow many different persons, places, and things, apart from their gods. But nothing can be made holy by men alone, neither can anything holy of earth be holy. That which is holy of and for God is holy, the place holy for God is holy and the person who lives holy for God is holy, but where on earth can such absoluteness be found? BRT 3:30 If by gathering in a temple, men feel they can better commune with God, then he will be there, and that place will be holy. If within a circle of stones or before a symbolic image, the soul of man may be stirred to attunement, then God will not absent himself because of the nature of the place. He will meet man wherever man earnestly prepares for his coming. Though the temple may be holy to one man and the circle of stones to another, both places will be hallowed by God, if therein, the souls of men are elevated to commune with him. BRT 3:31 A structure of splendor, magnificent in its architecture, called holy by men who worship there, if their spirits remain asleep and unstirred will not be hallowed by the presence of God. He does not honor places where men just congregate, where their voices alone are raised in worship. He hallows the place where their souls and spirits are uplifted as they seek communion with him. A holy place is where the uplifted spirits of men blend with the nature of God. BRT 3:32 A man asked, What of wisdom? Has this not been plentiful in the world since the days of the great enlighteners, of whom Solomon was deemed the greatest? Even before him, there was much wisdom, yet is earth a better place for this? What has it contributed to progress? Jesus replied, Alas, never has there been a shortage of wisdom in the world, but always there has been too little in the hearts of men. Wisdom is not something written in books, but that which is conveyed from the book of the heart. It is a way of life. BRT 3:33 All the wisdom of the past, held in reverence by some, was easier to write than to live by. Yet, following it is the only wisdom. Wisdom, however, is more than the thoughts of the wise, it is the accumulated philosophical knowledge of mankind winnowed by the wind of practicality. BRT 3:34 Nobility is an attribute of the soul, and no man has this by right of birth. Nobility demonstrates an ability to live and act according to the high principles. It is expressed in deeds, outlook and bearing, in the manner of life and relationship with others. That which ennobles a man is his recognition of something to love and strive for outside of himself. Nobility is the subordination of self to principles. BRT 3:35 Jesus was one, in whom all the virtues came to fruition, and his gentleness drew to him all his neighbors. In his presence, even enemies were reconciled, and this presence alone brought tranquility to a restless and sorrowful heart. In the street, even the little children followed him, just to touch his hand. BRT 3:36 His reaction to injustice and insult was a sorrowful compassion. He neither sought to acquire anything beyond his immediate needs nor treasured what he had. Beneath his soft exterior was a rock-like, immovable determination immune to oppression and suffering alike. Despite his gentleness, he could act decisively and swiftly, and when he had cause to strike in the name of justice and right, he never avoided the issue. BRT 3:37 His mind and wit were like the lightning flash. He was always keen and alert, and his face never lacked the calm beauty of cheerfulness. He was friendly towards all and acted so as not to annoy anyone. Only in the face of great injustice to another or oppression of the weak, or in the presence of gross hypocrisy did his wrath boil up and overflow, but never was it other than righteous. Though always compassionate and sympathetic, he was never sad or downcast. He rose above all suffering and pain, and ever seemed at peace within himself. BRT 3:38 Mary said to Jesus, To whom can your disciples be likened? Jesus said, They are like children at play in a field, which belongs to a stranger, and when the owner comes, they say, This is our field, therefore convey it to us. BRT 3:39 Thomas said, If the Spirit brought the body of flesh into being, it is a marvel. Jesus said, It would be a much greater miracle had the body brought the spirit into being, for the lesser cannot create the greater. I marvel how this great wealth of beauty can dwell in such a mean habitation. But to he who has goodness in his heart, goodness shall be given, he who lacks goodness shall be stripped of what he has. Brt 3:40 Jesus also said, just as it is impossible for any man to stretch two bows or mount two horses, so is it impossible for a man to serve two masters. Brt 3:41 The disciples asked, is circumcision a good thing? Jesus replied, if it were, would not children be born circumcised from the mother's womb? Only circumcision in the spirit confers true benefit. Brt 3:42 When asked concerning accounting, Jesus said, give to Caesar that, which is Caesar's, and to God that, which is God's. Give me what is justly mine, and keep for yourselves only that which is rightly your due. Deal fairly with all men, and shun the morals of the marketplace. Do not become like the Samaritans who, loving a tree, hate its fruits, or loving the fruit, hate the tree. The Pharisee is like a dog sleeping in the manger, from whence the oxen eat. It cannot eat what is in the manger, neither will it let the oxen eat. Brt 3:43 Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a woman carrying a jar of good wine. Being careless, she puts the jar down heavily and crashes it, and when she resumes her way, the wine spills out behind her on the road. But she blithely continues on her way, unaware of the spillage. When she enters the house, the master takes the wine jar and finds it empty. The disciples asked what this could mean, and Jesus replied, when you possess the good things of the kingdom of heaven, do not let them slip away. Brt 3:44 For the kingdom of heaven is neither here nor there and contains all good things. It is in the hearts of men and exists where God reigns. When the lion lies down with the lamb and peace reigns over all, there shall be found the kingdom of heaven. Yet truly, heaven and the kingdom of heaven are not the same. These things were said in the forecourt of the temple. Brt 3:45 Jesus took the disciples who were with him into the court of the Hebrews, which was an inner place, and a warden, a priest named Levi, stopped them, saying to Jesus, are you an ignorant man? Do you not know it is forbidden to walk here in the presence of holy things without first purifying yourselves? See, those who follow you have not even washed their feet. They enter here defiled by the world. Brt 3:46 Then, Jesus stopped and said to Levi, concern yourself with your own state rather than with ours. The priest replied, I am clean. Having bathed in David's pool, going down by one set of steps and coming up by another, only having done this and donned clean clothes have I come here. Jesus said, Lord, have mercy on the blind. You have washed in standing water, which may have been befouled by dogs, and scrubbed your outer skin as harlots, singing girls, and vain men do who are full of vileness inside. But my disciples and I have little need for outer forms of ritual cleanliness, being clean within, for we have washed in the living waters of the Spirit. Brt 3:47 Having departed from the temple, Jesus said, do not the guests assemble in the antechamber before entering the feast hall? There, the hands and feet are washed, the head anointed, and small foods to whet the appetite are eaten. Even so is the earth the antechamber of the kingdom of heaven. Brt 3:48 Live your lives in the world as men who journey through a strange land, marveling at its wonders, tasting its pleasures, but ever on guard against dangers, for undue love of the world is a doorway to evil. There are those who derive pleasure in being what they are not, but as their hair turns gray, they suffer sorrow and frustration. Be ever true to yourselves and to your natures. Brt 3:49 It came to pass, at this time, that many said that Jesus was the Messiah, but this was a manifest falsehood. Jesus, the son of Joseph and Mary, was an inspired prophet, a teacher who held the hand of God, and there had been others before him. His mother was a decent woman, both ate food as humans do. Mary did not set herself up as a goddess, neither did she preach. BRT 350 It is of no moment to those who are not Jews whether Jesus was the heralded Messiah or not, so believe as you will, but were he born of a Holy Ghost and not of Joseph, then he did not fulfill the prophecy. Men step outside the bounds of truth in their beliefs, but this, too, is of little moment unless they impose their beliefs on others. BRT 3:51 Jesus was not a sorrowful man, for greatness cannot be downcast. Always, he brought strength to the disheartened and was not influenced by the despondency of others. When Peter was dismayed and shut his sorrow within, Jesus said, "If my friend will not admit me into the antechamber of his sorrows, how can I ever sit in the reception room of his affections?" BRT 3:52 Jesus set his face against all forms of melancholy. He said, "The man who cannot rise above the burden of his sorrows or the trials of the day shall not know the kingdom of heaven, nor can he know the love, which is the cornerstone of life." BRT 3:53 There was a Greek scholar in the crowd, who said to Jesus, "Your never rusting tongue wearies me, words neither make men nor change things. It is the sword and spear which are all powerful and raise kings or cast them down." Jesus replied, "Truly, the words of scribes are greater than the commands of war chiefs. That which is written and read can not only change things but also endure forever. The sword gains prestige through destruction. But the pen of the scribe gains prestige through creating. That which destroys will be destroyed, that which creates shall be preserved." BRT 3:54 A Roman soldier who hailed from Gaul spoke up, saying, "Let scribes do what scribes do best and swordsmen do what they do best, but it is foolishness and futile to set one against the other, for men cannot write with swords, or fight with quills or writing reeds. Let men become brothers, as they await the day of the awakener. Tell me, good master, when shall the end be?" BRT 3:55 Jesus answered, "There will be an end to the beginning, and men will know this by the spirit of the times. Men will no longer be as brothers, nor will they be manly. Women will be as men and men as women. Adultery will not be condemned, nor will fornication, therefore, these will flourish. Men will not honor their homelands, and there will be no discrimination among them, nor will they maintain the purity of their races. Fathers will not be honored, nor mothers respected, and children will be raised to be wayward. Perversions will be encouraged, and criminals will mock the law. There will be incest and rape, and it will be unsafe to walk abroad. Floods, famines, droughts and earthquakes will cause death and destruction, strange sicknesses will smite the people, and there will be a denial of God. Babes will be slain in the womb." BRT 3:56 Men will lust after the wives of other men, and marriage shall lose its meaning. Women will go to the marriage table unchanged ast and with deceit in their hearts. Their husbands, creatures of pity, will hear the mocking voices of laughing men. Priests will defile their altars with their impurity, and the rulers will be held in little repute. It is not God who marks the end days, but men who lives as though setting a pitfall for himself. BRT 3:57 Jesus saw a man ill-treating a horse, and he rebuked him for his cruelty to a dumb animal. The man became angry and said, "This is my beast." Jesus said, "You are wrong, it is God's creature, and I, as his servant, am here to protect it. For no man can wholly own any living creature except it be in the name of the great God of life." BRT 3:58 This has been copied and edited as found. It appears to have been preceded by a document entitled, "The Sayings of Jesus." For some reason, it has been cut up into pieces, each containing just a few paragraphs. Included were other scraps from some much later source, which, for various reasons, are suspect. The latter part of this manuscript is probably a late if not modern edition, but it may have been rewritten from some older material. This has not been altered and is included under the authorization given to the compilers.